Welcome everyone. My name is George Peralta and I am the jewelry manager here at MS Rao. I'd like to welcome everyone to our 7th Bourbon with Bill webinar of our Bourbon with Bill series. I am subbing for the amazing Amanda Chun. She is off on maternity leave and I will do my best tonight to fill in her shoes. Tonight's topic is where we will be discussing 12 exquisite rings personally selected by Mr. Bill Rao. Before I introduce Mr. Bill Rao, I would like to remind that all questions are welcome tonight during the webinar, and we will try to get to as many as possible at the end. But feel free to ask any question. All you have to do is go to the bottom of the Zoom page there and hit the Q&A button and submit your question. And again, at the very end, we'll try to, or throughout the webinar, we will try to get to as many as we can. And we do not have videos today during the webinar, but you are more than welcome to visit our YouTube channel to see all the amazing videos and how the light reflects off of them in live through the video. And you can also visit our Instagram account, MS Rao Jewels, to see them. We're constantly posting all the new acquisitions and new pieces. I'd like to, without further ado, introduce Mr. Bill Rao. Bill, how are you today?
I'm doing great, George, and thanks for filling in for Amanda. You have large shoes to fill.
I really do. I feel the weight of them. I'm excited about tonight's presentation as we discuss these 12 different rings. But first, I'd like to talk a little bit about MS Rao as a whole and kind of the direction that we are heading this new year. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, certainly. We're using the pandemic as a great time to expand our jewelry area greatly. And when I say expand greatly, well, here's a picture of what it's going to look like. It doesn't look like it right now. This is our original building at 630 Royal Street, which we've been in since 1931, and I think was last renovated in 1950 something. We're getting ready to, and I'll show you what it looks like at the moment, but it doesn't look quite this good. We're getting ready to turn into really a jewelry area that looks, that shows our jewels off the way they should be showed off. And one of the problems of being an historical landmark like we are is that we can't just say we want a wider space or we want to add two more floors to our building or all those things. We can't do that because we're an historic building. So we have to go within the confines of what they allow us to do. Once we bought the two new buildings next to us and renovated those, and it gave us the space to be able to do this. This is a mock-up of what it's going to look like. It's actually, we've made a number of changes as always. This was the first mock-up, I don't know about y'all, but my screen's going back and forth, so I hope it's not getting anybody a little bit too nauseous. But it's something we're quite excited about. We're not there yet. I went over there today to do some construction questions, answer some, and I'll show you what it looks like today. So we got a ways to go. This was a picture that was taken today, going to the front street. Obviously, when I say we're going to the bricks and below the concrete, a little bit of interesting for you that know New Orleans well. Our building was the original house of the Acme Oyster House, mm-hmm. And so it's sort of interesting. And I never knew why, but from the front of the store to the back of the store, there's a 2-foot slant. In other words, the back of the gallery was 2 feet higher than to the front of the gallery, and we're tearing the concrete out and we're going to level it all up. But we found out now why is because that 2-foot slant was at the end of the night, so Acme Oyster House could wash up all the grease right into the street. It would just flow right to the street.
Okay, that explains.
Go back to the picture, George, 1 second. I'll just share one thing that I certainly did not know. I'm sure my father would have known my father, it's actually his birthday today, he'd be 101 if he was alive. But we have this wonderful on the arch on the left that you can sort of see between the gentleman and the little caterpillar machine. And, you know, you would have driven your horse through and, you know, to be able to use that as to use that as the carriageway. And so to me, it's just really cool. That was hidden up behind sheetrock my whole life. And it wasn't until we tore out the sheetrock that we knew it was there. But I know you didn't come, you didn't join in tonight to see this, but it's something we're excited about. And hopefully in about 5 or 6 months, it will look something like the pictures, but maybe even a little bit better.
I hope so, the same. But as you've mentioned, let's jump right into tonight's presentation. We're talking about these incredible rings. One of the reasons this excites me is because everybody gets to see a little bit behind the scenes of your excitement when something like this first ring comes into the gallery. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Well, certainly. So this is a pink diamond. To say pink diamonds are rare is somewhat of an understatement. And if they're rare now, they're not going to get any less rare. And I'll see if I can explain that. Maybe 25% of the world's pink diamonds, 30% of the world's pink diamonds were mined prior to 1960 or 1970. Since then, virtually every pink diamond's come from one mine in Australia, the Argyle Mines. The Argyle Mines closed at the end of last year. So there'll be no more pink diamonds that anybody envisions coming out of the ground anywhere in the world of any quantity. But even in its heyday, even in the a 3-carat pink diamond would be huge, a 5-carat would be tremendous, and anything over 10 carats is a great rarity. This is an 11-carat orangey pink. Now, orangey, with that, there's it on Amanda's hand. We still get to use her hand, even though
you don't want to see my hand.
She's on pregnancy, maternity leave. The term orangey is what's known as a modifier. In other words, it's a pink diamond with an orangey tint. If orange and the pink were the exact same colors, it would be an orange pink diamond. But orangey, so every stone, every color diamond that has a modifier, they're good modifiers and bad modifiers. Of all the modifiers for pink, orangey is the best, followed by purplish. And then there's a whole bunch that are bad, brownish pink, grayish pink. These are all bad modifiers that make the value less. Orangey pink increases. The reason why is orange and purplish are complementary colors to pink, and it makes the pink actually stronger. Most people, if they have never seen a pink diamond, they think, it would look like a Valentine almost,
Right.
It doesn't. It's a relatively pale stone. So this one's stronger than that. And to find an 11, it's just something that, it's not inexpensive by any stretch of the imagination. I think it's a great value, but it's something, if you offer me twice as much money as we're asking, we could not get another one. It just doesn't exist anywhere in the world, a plus 10 carat orangey pink, gem like this.
So in your experience, the rarity of diamonds, where does this color fall in the most rare?
Well, if you make a list of the rarest of the color diamonds, the rarest colors are red, orange, green, and then blue and pink, which I would put equally in rare in colors. But there's no such thing as a 10 carat red, and there's one 10 carat orange known. I think there's a 10 karat green known, so this is, as far as rarity, it's one of the great rare stones in the world. Whoever bought this offered it to Smithsonian and said, would you put this, next to the Hope, they would say, yeah, we'd be glad to. it's that type of thing that nobody else has. And it's just, one of the things that excites me is when you have a stone that when you have it in your hand, nobody's ever seen one like it. And people stop and go, ooh, what's that? And this is one of those great stones.
Absolutely. Again, like I mentioned before, seeing behind the scenes, something comes into our gallery, you hear about something, and then something that is extremely rare is what we call the chameleon diamond ring. And when you explain this, I think people are going to get the concept of why just this is so rare and so unique and what we'd love to find. Tell us about this chameleon diamond ring.
So first of all, I mean, everybody knows what a chameleon is. If you know, like a chameleon lizard, if it's on a tree bark, it'll be brown, and it goes on the tree leaf, it'll be green, and you know, it changes colors. Well, this is a diamond that changes colors, and it changes colors. We can, I think, go to the next slide. Yep, there is in two different colors. It changes colors if it's either heated, or if it's left in, you know, you put it in the safe for overnight, or in the, you know, in a box for overnight, and you take it out, and it's a different color. We really don't understand why it does this, but it's a natural phenomenon. It's extraordinarily rare. It's a greenish type diamond, but it's not considered a green diamond because it's a chameleon, because it changes colors. And it's one of those, wonderful rings. It has pink diamonds on the side that, once again, you have that nobody else has. And I, you know, I love the stone. I love the look of it. I'll share something with you. So here it is on Amanda's hand again, and it's pointing towards her hand, if you see. Now, 15 years ago, and throughout my whole career, that would have been pointing the wrong way. It was always, I was raised to believe, and every jeweler was raised, it was up to a certain point, that, you know, the point should head towards your finger. And then somewhere around 10, 15 years ago, that style, I sort of shifted. And now about half the people wear it this way, and half the people wear it pointing the other way. So there's not a right or wrong decision. But I, you know, I just find that sort of cool. But, you know, going back to the ring, it's just one of those rare diamonds that I think is quite undervalued for what it is, and that you have, and it doesn't look like anything else. You know, when you put it on, once again, this is the type of thing somebody would stop you and say, "Whoa, what is that?" And, you know, I love that type of jewelry.
Yeah, and this one in particular, surrounded by pink diamonds, is set in the 18 karat rose gold, just a beautiful complement to the uniqueness. But I love it's almost like Christmas when something like this comes into the gallery, where we hear, you know, about putting it in the dark or the heat aspect and the color change. So really unique and kind of on brand. We're gonna go to the section of our webinar where we discuss designer rings. I see questions coming in, and we'll get to them as time permits. But let's start with this one because it makes an impact. Our Tiffany and Company Asher Cut Diamond Ring. Bill.
So this one sort of breaks the mold, because everybody will know what this is when you have it on your hand.
Right.
It's extraordinary. First of all, it's a 20 carat Asher cut diamond. Asher was, let's go to the next picture. It might be better. Asher, you can see, this is actually good to see the ring. That's a great picture of it. Asher was a jewelry designer in the 1910s and 1920s, and he created what I think is one of the most beautiful, perhaps the most beautiful cut in a diamond ever. It's sort of a step cut. Let's go back a picture, if you don't mind, just for one second. Maybe we can see the step cut. On the right pic, well, both pictures, you can sort of see how it steps up as there's different levels, and so there's sort of a table, and it comes up. We can go to the next picture if you wish, and it's sort of a table, so it creates this like swimming pool effect when you look into it. But very few stones are cut in Asher cut, because stones are sold priced per carat. So if you have a ring that's 4 carats and you can make it 5 carats, it's worth so much more as a 5 carat, because if you're selling it for $20,000 a carat, a 5 carat stone is worth $100,000, and a 4 carat stone may be worth only $15,000 a carat. So it might be 4 times 15 is 60,000. So people don't tend to cut in Asher cut because it's too much waste. So to find a 20 carat Asher cut is mind-boggling. It's just this extraordinarily beautiful stone. One of the things I need to tell you, photographing white diamonds is very difficult. You just, when George mentioned earlier to go see our videos, a video is the way to see a gemstone, because it captures the light. A single picture does not capture the light. You know, it creates shadows and does all that stuff that you see the shadows in stone. When you see it in a video, and it just glows. So you have this extraordinarily perfectly cut 20 carat in a magnificent Tiffany mounting. that it's just the best of all worlds. It's, you know, a great firm Tiffany, a great diamond. And although everybody will know what this is when it's on their hand, nobody's ever seen one like this before. It's just something that's spectacular.
Absolutely. I can tell you from experience, when people walk into the gallery, that's the one they want to try on. They put their finger on the counter and say, that one. This next one is very timely, especially with Valentine's Day coming up. And again, a very popular designer, Cartier. And it's two heart-shaped stones, diamonds, that are significantly sized in this bypass ring. Tell me a little bit about this one.
Well, certainly. So first of all, when you think of the yellow, I want to, about 35 years ago, the highest rating the GIA, the independent lab that grades diamonds, gave a color diamonds was fancy color. They had faint color, light, and fancy. And then about 35 years ago, they realized that for the top of the market, for the top 1-2% of the market of fancy stones, people were willing to pay more. So they created a new category called fancy intense. Maybe about 5 or 6 years after that, they realized for that top 0.25% of fancy intense, that people were willing to pay more. And so they created a new category for that called fancy vivid. This is a fancy vivid yellow heart-shaped diamond, 3 carats. And it's just a screamer. It's hard to describe. I mean, you know, it's a type of stone, you know, if you put it on the front of your car, you know, you wouldn't need headlights. And it's next to an equivalent size 2.9 something carat white diamond, also heart shape, e-color, which is colorless, DEF, and white diamonds is considered colorless. And in a heart-shaped ring, it's just a stunning ring. I love crossover rings when they're done right. This one's done perfect. It's also one that's actually difficult to photograph because the stones are at different angles, so it's hard to focus on each one. But our photographer did a really good job. I love it. I love jewels that you don't see anywhere else. And to find something like this that's just the best. And one of the things I like when you see a Tiffany ring or a Cartier ring, especially old ones, often they went out and searched for the very best stones, and they paid a premium that other people wouldn't pay, because they knew they could get a premium when they put it in their mounting. And, you know, they wanted to tell somebody, hey, when you buy from Tiffany's, you're buying the very best. So yes, we're going to charge you more, or Cartier, we're going to charge you more, but yes, you're going to get something. But you could buy it blind knowing you're buying something great. And that's what I love about something like this. Although if you were blind, you'd be missing a lot of the beauty of this ring.
So a question that just came in, obviously we're calling this the previous 20 carat Tiffany ring, we're calling the Cartier a Cartier ring. How do we know that? What are some ways that we can know that and verify that?
Well, no, these are signed, the mountings are signed Cartier and they're signed Tiffany, and they're classic in the workmanship. These are easy to tell because they're signed, and if they were not signed, you couldn't, you know, unless you had a receipt from Cartier or a receipt from Tiffany. I'll share a horror story. 20 something years ago, we have a gentleman that lives in Missouri, and he came in and he bought a Cartier ring and he said, you know, I needed it sized down. It was too big. And our regular jeweler was on vacation, and we brought it to a jeweler that it was completely my mistake that we used him. And yes, he made it smaller. He cut out the bottom. He cut out the Cartier signature. And needless to say, the guy didn't buy the ring. I don't blame him. And it was an expensive learning lesson for us to be very careful. And the signature is very valuable. You either have to have a receipt, a document from Cartier from Tiffany, which is very hard to get. The receipts are the best, or the best is the signature.
Yeah, absolutely. That's great. We're going to move on to the section of our webinar where we talk about colored gemstones. And we're going to start off with my favorite color is blue. This is a Paribas tourmaline and diamond ring. And it's not quite bypassed. It's just two stones next to each other, two pear shapes next to each other. Why did this one excite you so much when it came into the gallery and it being a Paribas tourmaline? Why is that so special to you?
That's a great question, George. Pre-Tourmalines are one of the great gemstones in the world. It was a stone that was first found just a few decades ago in the Parima mines in Brazil, not terribly far from Rio de Janeiro. And it was found in the beginning and sort of still is in one mine in the world. And it has a unique color. In the trade, this is known, the perfect color is known as Windex blue. And you know, where that might not be the most complimentary term in some places, for Pariba, it is the perfect term. And you know, some people call it neon blue. It's just this striking blue color that once again does not exist in any other gemstone. And once again, this is a great picture of the mountain. You can sort of see how it is on the left and the right, and how sophisticated the mounting is to do this. Let's go back to the, maybe on Amanda's hand, if we have it. Yeah, there it is. It is so rare to find this color, and it's a Pariba that's 2 carats is considered big. So 4 carats is huge in a Brazilian Pariba. So let me explain one other thing. Maybe 15 years ago, 18 years ago, they found quote unquote Pariba tourmalines in Africa, in one mine in Africa. And those finding a 4 or 5 or 6 carat is not a rarity. However, they're not the same stone. They're both considered Pariba, but the ones in Brazil are colored with copper, and it's the copper that gives that neon Windex blue, that magnificent blue that this one has. That's better picture of the blue right here, where you can sort of see it. And the ones from Africa have more of a greenish tint. So, and where the ones in Africa get bigger, they're nowhere near as desirable. So to find a Brazilian Pariba tourmaline ring, and you know, the white diamond is a D color, which is colorless, and you know, it's just a gem. And it's, once again, you wear this, nobody's ever seen anything like it. And it's the type of thing that gives me great pleasure to own.
So I'm getting some questions on the setting, because it's quite obvious that the Pariba's 4.12 carats and the diamond is just under 3 carats, but they look very similar in size. Can you elaborate on that for us?
Certainly. So gemstones have different density. So obviously the denser a stone is, the smaller, carat is just a weight. It's not a size. So the denser something is, the smaller, you know, a 1 carat dense stone and a 1 carat stone that's not dense, the 1 carat stone that's not dense is going to look bigger. So a Pariba is a very dense stone. And because of that, the 4 carat and the under 3 carat look similar. But let's go back, that's a great picture. Let's go back 2 pictures to the mounting. If you can also see in the picture on the right, the Pariba is deeper than the white diamond. Mm. So some of that weight that you're seeing is in what we call the butt, you know, the bottom of the stone. And so that's a great question. So some of that weight difference, so it's not a 35% difference in density, but some of that is in the bottom of the stone, which you don't see. But the top of the stone, if we go back to that picture, the top of the stones are basically the same size. And that's where you see it. Now, having a little bit of depth on a colored stone is really good because it allows you to really get a deeper color. Think of it when you walk into the ocean or to the Gulf or to, you know, any giant water lake. The very beginning, the water's a little bit green, you know, then a little bit darker green, then maybe those shades of blue. And, you know, within a little bit of time, it's deep blue and then it's, you know, almost dark. So the deeper it gets, the darker it gets. And so a deeper colored stone is a good thing. And so this to me sort of has the best of all worlds.
Great. Our next gemstone here is a black opal and savorite garnet ring. So you have 2 stones kind of to speak about in relation to this one.
Well, certainly. And the star of the ring is the black opal. And the black opals come from one great mine in the world, the Lightning Ridge Mine in Australia. And you know, this is the mine that does these colors where you get the reds and the blues and the greens that this stone is just so fantastic with. It's a gem opal. And it was taken and obviously custom surrounded by a whole bunch of Savorites. Now, it's sort of interesting when you see the picture, go back to the first picture one second. When you see that picture, the savorite's sort of overwhelming, and you don't even, you know, the opal doesn't, but on your hand, go back to the one on the hand, really the opal is the star and the savorites just sort of surround it. This is a better picture of how the opal looks, although the opal's beauty looks better in the other picture. It's just a great ring, custom built. We don't know who made it. Obviously somebody spent a great deal of money on an opal and went to a jewelry designer and said, I want something that's unique. They pulled out one of the colors that are in the opal, that wonderful green, and got a whole bunch of savorites, which are rare stones. They come from Africa and to put around it. So to me, it's just a great ring. And once again, it's, I can't swear to this, but I would bet my bottom dollar it's the only one like it in the entire world.
So what are some of the desirable colors? You mentioned they have a large matrix of colors. What are some of the desirable colors in opals?
Well, that's a great question. And like a lot of gemstones, desirability is in the eye of the beholder. If you're a blue person and love blue, you're going to want to see a blue. If you're green, obviously. But the ones that bring the most money are the ones that have some red and orange in it. Like, you know, so if, and like, if you have it, this one has red, orange, purple, green, blue. It has every color in it, which is the most desirable from a, but it's not necessarily always the most beautiful to everybody. I've sometimes had four opals out, and the one that I like the least, you know, a whole bunch of people just love because they love the color that's in it that exposed the most. But that's a great question. But the wonderful thing about opals is they tend to, you know, different lights will bring out different colors. So like you could wear this inside your kitchen and you'll see some colors, and you walk into your living room with others, and you walk outside and you go, whoa, look at all the colors that are there. So it's sort of it's a chameleon of stones. Borrowing it from the diamond that we saw previously.
Yeah, I see that it tends to pull out colors even from what you're wearing. So as we talk about gemstones and our gemstone jewelry, I mean, as you were selecting them, we needed to talk about the top three. So we'll start with the first of the top three, which is this unheated cashmere sapphire ring. We get so excited whenever we find a cashmere like this. Tell me why this one is so special to you.
For somebody who's been dealing in jewelry as long as I have, you know, I cut my teeth on, you know, when I would go up to people that knew so much more than I did when I was young, and, you know, I would ask them a question, you know, and, you know, 40 years ago, people, not that people aren't snobs today, but, you know, the old timers, I considered them educated snobs, and I would show them something, and go, ah, yeah, it's not a cashmere, you know, and they would sort of push it aside, like, and so a little bit about cashmeres. You can keep this picture up for a minute. Cashmeres, they're mystical. The mines closed somewhere about 1904, 1903, there was a giant flood and the mines closed. And since then, only a handful of stones have ever come out of the ground. And they were only open for about 25 or 30 years. But when the mines were open, they yielded the most beautiful, it's called cornflower blue. This color, at least on my screen, and I don't know how it looks on your screen because everybody's screen is always a little bit different. This color is a little bit darker than it is in person. It's just a soft, beautiful, you know, color that's unlike any other sapphire. And you know, it's a stone that almost certainly was mined, you know, 140 years ago. There's the area of Kashmir. Kashmir is the area that India and Pakistan are always arguing over who should own it. It's controlled by India. It's mostly a Muslim country. So Pakistan certainly feels a kinship towards it that it should be part of Pakistan. And it's very remote. I think we have another picture. Yeah, it's very remote. And this is actually the mines of Kashmir. This was taken when the mines were open, you know, a long time ago, and, you know, going on horseback, climbing the mountains, and, you know, it was very remote. And this was obviously in the summer, because in the winter, this is ice packed in snow. It's a remote place, and to find Kashmir sapphires, you know, it's just, to me, it's a gem. There it is on Amanda's hand. And it's it's just such a sophisticated stone. And once again, it's a color like no other sapphire. And for most people, and once again, beauty is always in the eye of the beholder. This is the ultimate, you know, to be able to get a cashmere. And, you know, and it's a very wearable ring. It's a ring that you could wear every single day, which I love.
And, we talk all the time about different specs on gemstones, but someone asked, what does the untreated mean? Can you elaborate a little bit on that for us?
Certainly. So somewhere in the neighborhood of 90%, maybe, no, it's probably 95% of all sapphires anybody's ever seen have been treated. And what I mean by treated, when they took them out of the ground, they heated them, because they didn't come out of the ground looking this blue. And so if you heat a stone, it brings out the color of blue, but it also destroys some of the silk inside. It destroys some of the beauty inside of the stone. And so what happens is, you know, you heat it and the color's better, but the inside is not as nice. But at least 95% of all sapphires have been treated. So to find an untreated one or unheated, which the only way you treat a sapphire is by heating it. So untreated and unheated are synonymous, is really, really desirable. I'll share a story with you. It's a great business story more than anything else. Roughly 1870s, 1880s, they found sapphires in Montana. None of them ever got any big. I mean, a giant one was a carat or a carat and a half. Beautiful stones, and they were not treated. They mined them for a number of years, and then it wasn't financially feasible to keep doing, and they stopped. And sometime around 1960, somebody had the idea to open the mines again, because there were still all these stones in the ground. Now, the one thing about mining is the first stone costs you something like $35 or $40 million to get, and the second stone costs you a penny, because, you know, you have to build the roads, you have to get the equipment, you have to do all the stuff, prepare everything. Now, the thing is, so they got a whole bunch of investors to invest in this mine. And in those days, virtually all jewelry was sold through jewelry stores. I mean, you didn't see ads in Cosmopolitan or ads in Architecture Digest or, you know, ads on web TV or whatever. And you didn't see this. So the only way you would know about these is you would walk to your jeweler and say, "What's new?" And your local jeweler would tell you. Well, they had an idea. Well, let's sell this to the jewelers. And so they made these big posters. They sent to jewelers. Montana sapphire, the only sapphire that's not treated, because in those days, obviously, cashmeres, you know, had quit being mined. Burma sapphires, which typically are not heated, you know, were not being mined with any regularity. So that any stone that anybody there had seen was more than likely from India or from Sri Lanka, and they were all treated. And so they sent all these posters to not every jeweler, but thousands of jewelers, and it bombed. It completely bombed, and they didn't sell, and the whole project went bankrupt. A number of years later, Harvard did a study on why did it fail. You know, these were stones that were beautiful, that had everything priced right. Why did it fail? And it failed, they found out, because they were marketing in the wrong way. They wanted to give these signs to the jeweler saying, you know, the only stone that's not treated. But the problem was the jewelers didn't want to put that out, because they didn't want somebody going, "Wait, the sapphire I bought last year, is that treated? Why didn't you tell me? You know, is my emerald treated? Is my ruby treated?" And, you know, so none of the jewelers wanted to open that can of worms. So they didn't even try and sell it that way. They didn't market it that way. And so needless to say, its best attribute failed them. So that's why you rarely see a Montana sapphire, because, you know, they were mined for just a few short years in the 1880s and for one short year in the 1960s. But going back to this one, this is an untreated, unheated, perfect cashmere sapphire, and it's the top of the food chain as far as sapphires.
Great. So that our next stone, again, one of the most known types of gemstones is ruby. It has the same moniker, you know, untreated ruby and diamond ring. Tell us a little bit about this one.
Well, so this is a perfect pigeon blood red ruby, and it's also untreated, unheated. That's the way you treat a ruby, is to heat it. You have heard me on this before, you know this, but a ruby and a sapphire are the exact same stone. If it's red, it's a ruby. If it's every other color in the rainbow, it's a sapphire. So obviously they would be treated the same way. And the ideal color is this really pigeon blood red. Do we have a picture of it on Amanda's hand? Well, that's a better picture of it right there. The one on the right really shows the color, at least on my screen. Once again, I don't know how it looks on yours, but it's just a beautiful, what's known as pigeon blood red. This in my screen, at least a little look pink in the center. Once again, if you go to either our website or YouTube or Instagram, and you go to just even to our website, rowantiques.com, and put in ruby, this will come up. And you could click on, and there's a video there, so you can see it, and you can see its true color without, because you'll see how the light hits it. But it's just a beautiful, rare stone, and rubies are far rarer than, they're not far rarer than a cashmere sapphire, but they're far rarer than any sapphire. And to find an untreated ruby where certainly 95 or 98% of the ones that are out there are treated, makes this a really great gem.
So someone asks, can a person tell if a stone is treated or untreated with just their eyes, or does it require a special device to see this aspect?
That's a great question. There are tests that you can put into a thing that it's a scientific test, and so it's not an opinion. Like when we talk about the difference between like a D and an E color diamond, that's an opinion. I've heard people argue for days, no, it's a D, no, it's an E. And obviously it's the seller saying it's a D and it's the buyer saying it's an E because there's a price difference. But, those are opinions. This is a scientific fact. It's either been treated or not. There's a test. A good jeweler, I can look at a stone and be 98% sure whether it's been treated or not. Regardless, we still send this to an independent lab to get tested. Because I don't want my opinion on the thing. I want an independent lab saying yes, it's been treated, or no, it's not been treated. So that's a great question.
Great, thank you, Bill. And then this one, we were back and forth on whether it should be with the designers, whether it should be in the colored gemstone emerald section. This also has the moniker untreated. It's Colombian emerald ring by Fred Layton. So this one checks off a lot of boxes, Bill. Tell us which ones those are.
Well, since we're talking about gemstones, let's talk about the emerald. The emerald is something that's really great. Whereas, I mentioned that somewhere between 90 and 95% of all sapphires in the world are treated, mm-hmm. and somewhere between 96 and 98% of all rubies are treated. I am not exaggerating what I'm about to say. 99.9999999% of all emeralds have been treated. Emeralds are not treated with heat, they're treated with oil. Mm. Why are they treated? Of all the precious gemstones, emeralds is by far the most porous. They're the ones with the most inclusions. And so what they'll do is when they come out of the ground, they put them in this giant vat and they have a green oil and they use pressure to force the oil into the stones. And it fills up the fissures, it fills up the cracks, it fills up the inclusions of the stone and it makes it look cleaner. And virtually every emerald that you've seen has been treated like that. So to find an untreated emerald, once again, it came out of the ground like this, cut in a very rare shape. This is an octagonal shape. It's okay. Just go back one picture just so they can see the octagonal shape on it, which is quite rare. And we can go, and then put into an extraordinary mounting. The mounting is by Fred Layton. These are all yellow and orange and all multicolored diamonds and champagne color diamonds in the mounting. Fred Layton is and was, but in their day, I say was one of the great jewelers. They were Madison Avenue. The gentleman that owned it that died, he died about a year and a half ago, was just this great jeweler and had just extraordinary taste but to find an emerald like this that's so clean, that's so see-through. Now, one of the problems of oiling an emerald is that the day you buy it, and if you keep it long enough, and certainly if you wash your dishes with it, if you shower with it, if you go swimming with it, over a period of time, the oil starts to seep out. So It's very gradual, but it just won't be as pretty as it was. This will always look like that. I mean, it's just a gem, screaming emerald. That's great, you know. And once again, Fred Layton was not unlike Tiffany's or Cartier. He would go out and search for the finest jewels that there were, and then make a special mounting for it. He was on Madison Avenue. He also had a, and I'm not sure if it's still there or not, he had a shop in the Bellagio in Las Vegas that was just amazing to go into. And I always enjoyed being around him. We did shows together, and because his stuff was, you know, it was just over the top, and this is a great example.
Yeah. So the title Colombian is highlighted in this ring. Why is that so important?
That's a great question. So origin is important on stones. The market is willing to pay more for certain stones. You know, they were willing to pay much more for a cashmere sapphire than one from Ceylon. But in emeralds, the catchword is Colombia. It's just, there's no other place. And particularly one mine called the Muso Mines, which yielded emeralds to the richest grass green color, which this is. And so it's interesting when the emeralds, when this type of emerald came out, you know, in when I was young, the old timers would call this either an old world, well, they would typically call it an old world emerald. And for decades, people thought these emeralds actually came from India, because when they were first mined by the Spanish in the 1500s, they were sent to India. Now think about this, they were sent to Spain and then sent to India to be cut, because nobody knew how to cut emeralds like the Indians did. And then so when they came back on the market, they came back via India. So, you know, the old timers used to think that these were from Colombia. Today you can tell for certainty, old timers used to think they were from India. You can tell for certainty because we know how to look at inclusions now, and that these match the inclusions of the ones from Colombia, that they're definitely Colombian stones, but they're that rich, you know, grass green color. And so, you know, it's the best emerald, cleanest, best color from the single best mine in the world. So that's why it's important. Thanks for asking, George.
Yeah, not a problem. Thank you to our viewers for asking these really important questions. It opens up our eyes to, you know, we know these things, we know untreated, we know Colombian, but it's great to hear from everybody what's important to them and what they'd like to know a little bit more about. Okay, so we're always talking, Bill, about these rare stones, and we say it 10 times over, and then we get to a ring like this, our next ring, a demantoid garnet bypass ring. So this one is just next level to me. I want you to share with everyone why it's next level.
So one of the reasons diamonds are what I would say, you know, have always been so highly valued and so well thought of is they share two attributes. First of all, it's the hardest substance in the world.
Right.
The second hardest being a ruby and a sapphire. And the second reason why diamonds is, up until this stone was found, it had the greatest light dispersion of any stone in the world. Mm-hmm. So a diamond, one light would come in, and typically 64 lights in a perfect cut stone would come out. And when the demantoid garnet was found, it was only a gemstone that's ever been found that had a higher light dispersion than a diamond. It was found in the Ural Mountains in Russia in the second half of the 19th century. And these are roughly 2.6, 2.7 carats each, which is huge for a demantoid. Most demantoids are half a carat, a quarter carat. And they have this distinctive green, unlike any other gem. I can't describe it. But it's just a beautiful green, and it glows. And most demantoids are, you know, literally one fifth or one sixth the size or one eighth the size. So to find two matching round cuts, round is rare in a demantoid, and to find right. two matching round cuts that are, you know, and put into a ring, it's just great. And once over, this is a bypass ring or a crossover ring, depending on, you know, how you like to call it. And it's beautiful. And it's the type of thing that excites me because I've never seen it before. I've owned demantoids. I love demantoids. I go out of my way to buy them. If you told me you had demantoids, I'll try my best to get there and go see them. But, you know, to find something like this with a pair of them in one, it's just something that's special.
Absolutely. So you mentioned that they're Russian. Obviously, we have a certification saying that. Why, besides being mined there in Russia, what makes that just a little bit more special in these types of garnets?
That's a great question. So whoever asked that. So there are demetroids found in other places, but they're nowhere near as pretty, nowhere near as desirable. But one of the things the Russian the demetroids have what's known as a horsehair inclusion. Hmm. So the inclusion sort of looks, imagine if you think of horsehair, coming out, it has that, that sprayed look of an inclusion that demetroids from other places don't have. So, when you're looking at old stones and old rings that are almost never certified because they're sitting in an antique piece of jewelry from 1870 or 1880, what you look for is that horsetail inclusion. And that's not necessarily fair what I just said, because if it was from 1870 or 1880, it had to have been Russian because it's the only place they were mined. But, like 1920s and 30s, if you found one, there were stones that were found in other places, but, typically the color or the vibrancy is not as good. So to have these two wonderful light dispersing, perfect color green, it thrills me.
Yeah, it's so exciting to have something like that. And again, I see some questions rolling in. We're going to try to get to them towards the end of the webinar, but I definitely want to make sure we get to this portion of our webinar where we talk about something we've been acquiring lately, which is celebrity ring. And the first one we're starting off with, you may know this guy, Prince Jewelry. Tell us about the pieces we've been acquiring and one in particular.
So this is Prince's golden diamond ring. And so first of all, I need to come clean with everybody. I'm going to show a little bit of my age. We had been fortunate, had a connection to get some wonderful Elvis jewelry, and which I was just so thrilled with. And I remember when I was young, arguing with an older cousin of mine, I was talking about how big the Beatles were, and she looked at me and she pointed right in my face and goes, "They were nowhere as big as Elvis," and just from that memory where I almost got beat up by my older cousin, I realized how important, Elvis was. So through a contact, Prince's widow has some jewelry to sell, and some other Prince memorabilia, including a stage outfit and so forth. And we were approached, and my first thought was no. It's like, nah, I don't think. And I remember bringing it to the jewelry counter. And I said, "What do y'all think of this?" And I had George at the counter, who's on the call with us, and two or three other people that were a good bit younger than I am. And their eyes, and they're Prince's jewelry, and they were doing backflips. And I realized that I was, completely wrong. That what didn't appeal to me, because Prince's, the purple rain and the never rained on me, and yet for some people, Prince was their Elvis, or, my Beatles, or whatever the case was. So, we've been able to get a number of pieces of Prince's. This is one of the, one of the rings that he wore, and it's just a lovely ring. It's not, compared to every other ring that we've showed you, it's not what I would call a great piece of jewelry. It's a nice piece of jewelry, but it has this phenomenal provenance. Yeah, and provenance is the most important factor in almost anything. And to give you an example, if you think of, what would be the world's most valuable sapphire, I would say clearly it would be the one that Princess Di received from Prince Charles as a wedding gift, that's now on their daughter-in-law's hand. That sapphire by itself is worth $400,000, but I'm willing to wager if they put that ring in auction, it would bring $25 million or $20 million. It's the most famous sapphire, and the provenance of that ring is worth so much more than the sapphire itself. The same with this, and for the people that I've learned, and I'm the first one to admit that I'm eating crow, is that, and I was wrong, Prince, for a lot of people was just He was a game changer, and to have a piece of his jewelry is so amazing.
So
this is so inexpensive. It's $14,500. I mean, it's just great.
When people come into the gallery, obviously we have antiques from princes and kings of past, and they see the tag, they ask, you know, which prince? And I'm like, the one. and so this is more, as you put it yourself, in your wheelhouse as a celebrity. And we have some pieces from Elvis Presley. Tell us about that.
Well, the king of bling, and whereas the prince's jewelry, I would say, was somewhat understated, Elvis didn't have that problem. And you know, this is one from the 1960s with his initials on it, specially made for him, and was given to a friend of his, and was in the Elvis Presley Museum for a while. And it's a ring that I love. I think it's so freaking exciting. However, if it wasn't Elvis Presley's, there's no way I would be caught dead in it. I mean, you know, it is gaudy with a capital G, but that's okay. You know, it is so freaking cool because of who it was owned by. And, once again, you know, this was owned by the king. It was owned by, you know, for certain people that, you know, Elvis was not a musician. He was not a movie star. He was a cultural phenomenon. And there were very, very, very few people that ever transposed, transposed all the different ways of entertainment that he did. And he's one of those people that it's also, there's not many people out there that were known by one name. And if you say the name Elvis, you don't have to say the name Presley after it. You know, so, but to have this ring, it's just great. It can be sized, but Elvis had big hands, and so it's a big ring, but we can size it. I would not buy this for a petite female, a petite female with petite hands, petite hand female. Because it would swallow her, unless you wore it as a necklace or something. But other than that, I just think it's so super cool.
Wow, Bill. So we talked about 12 rings and we really appreciate your time and just sharing that. I'm excited again because, this is what we do. We talk about all the time and we're giving a sneak peek behind the scenes of your excitement when you come in, when you purchase these jewelries. So some of the questions is, where do you acquire these pieces from?
We look hard. One of the advantages of being in business, that's a good question, whoever asked it. We've been in business 109 years, and one of the advantages, you know, many of these things, not necessarily this grouping of jewelry, but many of these things we've owned two and three and four times before. We've owned them and we buy them back. I'm a little bit disappointed today on the buying back stage. I've received in the past 2 days about 75 emails. We sold Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie a painting by Winston Churchill it was the only painting that he painted during World War II. And he gave it to Franklin Roosevelt at a pivotal moment in the war. It's just this extraordinary work of art. I made Brad Pitt promise me that if he ever sold it, he would sell it back to us. Anyway, Brad Pitt, as most people know, and Angelina Jolie are no longer together. She owns it and she didn't uphold that promise, and they're putting in an auction in Europe where it's going to bring $3.5 or $4 million, and it just breaks my heart that we're not getting that one back. But going back to your original question, a lot of jewelry we've owned before, but just importantly, we're known for these great pieces. So when somebody has something great, you know, we'll get calls out of the blue all the time. Hey, I know that you're interested. I know that, you know, you like things like this. Would this be of interest to you? And, you know, and the answer is, you know, 99.99% of the time, no, but that 1/1000% of the time, the answer is yes. And that's the ones we get excited about.
Yeah, absolutely. So some of the ones that we spoke about tonight, is there one, you know, that just stands out to you right now as very exciting, or is the piece coming in or that we've had recently that was just very exciting to you?
No, I really, when I picked these out, I picked out all the ones that were exciting to me. So, you know, these are all my favorite children, you know, right? and we have more favorite children in the jewelry world, but those are ones that definitely do excite me but not one more than others, but you know, if you ask my daughter, who's you know, she would say it'd be the last one I bought is the one that excites me the most.
I understand. So another question, and again, just to remind everyone, if you'd like to ask any other questions, just hit the Q&A button at the bottom of the Zoom screen there, and we'll try to get to a few more here now. So someone asks, is it worth investing in jewelry? So that's a, just, you know, people are very investment minded right now. There's a lot of it in the media and talk about investing. What's your perspective on jewelry and investment?
That's a great question. So I'm going to give you a couple of different answers. The most important thing is I don't believe that somebody should buy something like this for investment. I believe somebody should buy something like this because it gives them great pleasure. Mm-hmm. Having said that, the type of things, virtually everything I showed you today, there's no more of them. You know, there's no more, you know, 10 karat plus orangey pinks, you know, there's, you know, that, you know, there's no more, you know, demetory garnets or Pariba tourmalines or no oil emeralds or cashmere sapphires. So that type of stuff, it's my belief, will continue to rise in value. And it's a really good place to have it as an alternative asset. And I could give you, this would take far longer in this webinar, a whole bunch of mathematical reasons why I believe that. But my overall belief, people have asked me all the time, you know, what should I collect that, you know, great investment? And my, buy something that gives you pleasure, because the best investment is one that pays a dividend every day you wear it, or every day you see it. And, you know, I have something on the center of my dining room table that every night I go in there and I look at it, I get a pleasure out of it. And yeah, that's the best investment there is.
Great answer to that, Bill. Is it easy? We see many pieces come through the gallery. Is it easy for you to tell the period of a jewelry piece? So are there any tips that you may be able to share with, you know, the period of pieces? Is it Art Deco? Is it retro? Is it modern?
There's no tips I could give, but you can tell. And workmanship changed, labor changed, styles changed, the way they cut diamonds changed, the way they cut gemstones changed, the way they set things changed. And so, you know, and it didn't change from a Friday to a Saturday, but it did change gradually. So it's really easy to tell when things are period or not period. There's no tips I could give you. If you were wanted to learn about deco jewelry and wanted to spend an hour with me, I would be overjoyed to show you some things that are deco and then things that are in the deco style that were made after. And you can sort of see the difference. The weight is different. The feel is different. The look is a little bit different. But there's no cheating, you know, that can say, well, if you look at this, that you'll know, but it's not anything like that. But it's like anything else. Once you see enough of it, I'm sure some of the people on this call have read the book Blink by Malcolm Gladwell. And it started off by an expert walking into the J. Paul Getty Museum, and they were showing him a statue, and how long it takes to blink, he knew something was wrong with it. And it turned out to be a fake. And he couldn't say why. He just knew instinctively something was wrong. And once you see enough of anything, you know, you can just sort of tell. I mean, you can hold 20 of them in the 21st of them. It doesn't look right.
Yeah. So someone says, if I was getting a certification, what are some of the places I would go to get them from? Obviously, you can speak to that, some of the certificates and where we get them from.
No, it's great. It's a great question. So for diamonds, it's the GIA. You know, if you're dealing with a diamond, you want a GIA certificate, Gemological Institute of America. They're by far the most prestigious. And all these labs are independent labs. For colored stones, you ideally would not want to go to the GIA. There's three great labs, the AGL, American Gemological Laboratories, Gublin in Switzerland, and SSEF in Switzerland. These are the three big labs. One is not better than others. It's interesting that, like, the Chinese like Gublin and SSEF over AGL. Most people like AGL for certain stones over there. But the reality is they're all great. And as long as you go to one of those three labs for any of the colored stones and the GIA for a white diamond, you're fine.
Yeah, that's great. Someone I believe joined us a little late is asking about the expansion again. Are we going to have more jewelry than what we have now?
Well, we're not only have more jewelry, we've also had an incredible amount that's in our safe. You know, one of the problems of being in an historic building, an old building, is that, you know, our jewelry area was quite tight and we squeezed a lot in there. And, you know, I hated the fact that we would have these magnificent pieces and it didn't look magnificent squeezed in. So, but yeah, we have been looking, we have been stocking up for some, for when we're going to be ready. And I promise you, you know, for you to get to come and come see us, you're going to see some really great pieces.
Absolutely. Well, Bill, I want to thank you so much for the time that you gave us and just talking about this. And I want to share with everyone who joined us, you know, there's plenty of questions. And if we weren't able to get to your questions tonight, feel free to email me, george@rowantiques.com. And I'd love to answer any of those questions. Again, Bill, thank you for the time that you've given us tonight. At the end of this webinar, you may receive a pop-up survey. Please fill that out so that we can improve the next Bourbon with Bill and make it even better for you. Thank you all for joining us tonight, and we hope you have a great evening. Take care.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill.